The first of our three panel discussions is going to be moderated by Richard Berkley here, a friend from PA Consulting. We have some extraordinary guests with some extraordinary stories, and I'll hand over to you. Would you like this mic?
I've got, I'm all mic'd up, which is great. Yes. Hello. So I'm Richard Berkley. As you say, I'm from PA Consulting. So partner that run data analytics and the AI there. We're about a firm of about 4,000 people, UK-centric, and we work across all industries, do anything from strategy through to implementation, particularly with data and AI. And we have a great topic here, and quite a diverse panel that is, I think, has got a lot to say on this topic. So what we're going to do, we're limited on time, is ask each of them to introduce themselves and also say what they are doing with AI at the moment. So, Himanshu, shall we start at this end?
Thank you. Myself, Himanshu Jha, I'm responsible for what we call fraud and financial crime engineering at Nationwide Billing Society. That's pretty much it. Perhaps the questions will cover what you're doing.
Why don't you just say a bit about what you're doing with AI to get us going as well.
I mean, following the absolute wonderful act by Jeremy, right? So I think he did say in the end that regulated industries and... But the key thing in regulated is we still exist for customers. And as we saw in the digital revolution, wherever the customers are heading, we got to head that way. Albeit small steps, careful steps. So we're applying AI pretty much across all these spheres. And most importantly, customer servicing. There is a lot of, we talked about drudgery, a lot of monotonous activity. From that on end to actually, giving specific personalized advice for products like mortgages, finding out vulnerability within the customers in terms of credit risk, et cetera. And then a little bit more sophisticated, some of the best fraud detection models, which we ought to have considering the challenge of fraud, et cetera, are implementing increasingly. So in terms of touching the surface, we're pretty much touching the very important customer facing and kind of pound affecting in our process. But there's no end to the sophistication that we can reach. So it'll be a journey.
Yeah. Right. So we'll come back to some of those. Michael? Same question. Introduce yourself and what are you doing with AI?
Yeah, thank you, Richard, and thank you to DataStax for having me. I'm Michael. I'm VP of Engineering and Data at a fintech called Bud. So we work with financial services institutions, banks, fintechs, core banking providers to, at the very base, understand transactional data. So you've just spent £10 in Sainsbury's or you've just paid your rent and so on and so forth. And we do that so that those transactions, they're actually unstructured data. They have structure, but you don't often know what the structure is. So trying to understand what that is, understand the who, the what, the where, the why. And we then build that into an understanding of a customer. So it's no longer a bunch of transactions. You're now John. You now have a salary of 10K a year. You have this income variability. You shop at Waitrose in this part of London, but you live in this part of London, and so on and so forth. And in terms of AI, there's all the we're a tech company, we're a fintech. We're obviously using AI internally a lot, but the way that we're achieving a lot of this in terms of whether that's at the transactional layer or at the customer level, how we're able to turn that into actions, we're using AI to do that. And I think the key thing for us is AI is not the answer. It's the way of getting to the solution. What matters is the value that you're delivering, and is it the right solution to what you're trying to solve? So we've been using LLMs to understand transactional data since before ChatGPT, before LLMs were cool. Why? Because it made sense, right? It was the right solution for the problem, and I think that's the kind of really key thing, and that's what we focus on. We focus on the outcomes. We happen to be using AI to get us there, and that's what I think enables us to do it well. But right. that's I think
fantastic.
The key thing.
And Thomas, introduce yourself.
Yes, thank you. So I'm Thomas Boltze. I'm running enterprise architecture for PagoNxt Merchant Solutions, an acquiring business. We're in Brazil, we're in Mexico, we're in Spain, Portugal, part of other companies. We're part of Santander Group. So we have a very interesting problem that we have about 1,000 developers, thousands of Git repos and very little documentation of our code. As a consequence, we have massive duplication. We also have acquired a number of different companies, so we have four platforms to do the same thing with sometimes eight billing systems and so forth. The mission now is to say, how do we consolidate this into one single platform? If we can't discover our code base, we cannot, or not with reasonable time. So what we're doing with AI is we take the entire code base, we chunk it up, stick it into a vector search, run an LLM on top of that, and generate documentation that we push back to GitHub as a pull request, and from there bring it straight into the IDP, backstage in this case, so that the developers have it at their fingertips when they need it. And that's the first step, and that's easy-ish. Right? The next step that we've built then is the capability to ask your code-based questions. So I can now go to backstage and ask, do we have a component that uses Vault? Or which components manage customers' addresses? Or how should I refactor this microservice? And I can do this in the IDP, so all of a sudden, as a developer, I can discover what I have. And that makes a huge difference to productivity, as you can imagine. Before, to answer those questions, well, you can ask lots of colleagues, you can go to Wiki and hope that there's any truth on there, or you can read all the Git repos, which nobody does. And now we can ask the codebase questions, which makes a huge difference.
And just picking up on that, Thomas, in terms of that productivity that you've talked about,
yeah.
Are you being able to measure that? Are you able to see what impact that's having for your business?
So it's too early for us to have the actual measurements on that, but what we're looking at is velocity, lead time, incidents in production, overlap of functionality, and burnout. So I think Jeremy made a very strong case that having Copilot is great for developers. I think this will have exactly the same effect. And Google has done a lot of research on this as well. So having good quality documentation augments all your CI/CD practices. Yeah? So I think we look forward to being able to come back in a year and say, okay, this is what we've seen, but it's too early for us to say.
Yeah, right. So productivity is often a first use case. I think a lot of firms are looking at how they generate additional revenue. And Michael, you started talking about personalization and exploiting customer data. So again, are you starting to see benefits come through, and how are you realizing that?
Yeah, most definitely. I think, 30 years ago, we would have a relationship with your bank manager, right? You'd go into branch, they would know that your sister just got married, they'd know your financial situation, you could have a conversation with them. And that's still possible with many banks today. I've seen the Nationwide adverts emphasizing that point. But what we've also now got is this digital age, right? It's about being able to deliver at the point of need. At that point when you're like, I wonder how much I've got in my bank account, or you can just instantly, at your fingertips, go and get that information. But what we've lost along that process is that understanding of the customers and the ability to act on it. And I think using AI is where we can start to bring back some of that more, and I almost dislike the word personalization now because we overuse it, but like that personal feeling mm-hmm. to banking, and not just banking, but other sort of industries as well, because you can now tailor it to the individual. There is no point building a chatbot that with using LLMs and so on and so forth if you're not going to then also bring in stuff that is specific to that customer. If you're just going and looking at a wiki or whatever, there are simpler ways of doing that that have existed before sort of LLMs were popular. But what LLMs allow you to do is they allow you to be flexible and personalized in every single one of those situations. So it's, if you're going to use AI, why are you using AI? And then make sure you get all the benefit from it. I think that's what, in the space of personalization, it can really give you.
Great. And Himanshu, you also talked about using AI in terms of understanding the customer better, both in terms of financial crime, but also in terms of the customer experience. So is it similar? Are you close to using it with customers directly?
Yeah, a couple of things. Very obvious, of course, we are using it. But I think what AI makes at the back of the previous revolution, shall I say, big data and analytics, et cetera, is that it helps you to get more and more scale. And that's a wider piece, but also if you do it well, then a deeper piece. But the key thing there is not so much personalizing the content, but actually knowing very personally the need of it, which gets a little bit embedded, and that's where more sophistication is needed. Because not so much about the content, but we talk about omni-channel in the time of need, relevant. Relevant perhaps is okay, but is the need for such a saturated industry, shall I say, banking, is the need perhaps is the most important thing to discover person by person. So I've been at places where across millions of customers, you know, we would have used not so much AI, but machine learning to really have rank scored every product that the bank can service, and then, you know, some trigger for that need moment arising, and then you matching your content with the surfacing of the product and offer. So broad point I'm making is, of course, it'll progress the personalization journey, definitely wider, give you scale, let you make more omni-channel, et cetera. But the key thing with banking and societies and these things are that you will see it being full scale maybe 6, 7, 10 years later than, you know, perhaps, you know, less regulated industries are, and then you are no more surprised by it. That's the kind of non-sexy nature of, you know, some of the stuff that we do. But it's definitely aiding and definitely helping us closer to the need and getting the scale.
Yeah, so you're saying there perhaps banking might be slower at adopting it, but nevertheless, you are using AI to understand millions of customers. So how do you address those concerns around compliance and security of data?
Yeah, at the outset, right, I think previous speakers spoke about a lot what could go wrong. So we think long and hard about what could go wrong. In fact, that's one of the reasons, first of all, these organizations are large and various units within them, and you got to have a consensus in terms of how much governance and how much flexibility and creativity, et cetera. So we spent a long time establishing the guardrails, so not just for AI, but pretty much everything. You know, previous revolution, data analytics, cloud revolution, take whatever revolution, and we take a long time establishing our guardrails, what we call. And then this next set of time is taken in really being specific, because, you know, we can afford to build our own models as well, but should we be doing it? Are there more efficient ways? So our kind of by design principle is that we ought to be compliant and a little bit overly compliant. And so we trade that we might even have less creativity, but be more compliant than even required right from beginning. There's no opportunity for afterthought. So absolutely, it's kind of built by design, and therefore it takes time for us to kind of get started and get into more use cases delivery.
So you said there, it's taking time, but you've got that tension, those guardrails that I'm sure are being driven by compliance, and yet you've also got a whole host of innovators who are looking to move forward. So how do you manage that tension?
It's a healthy tension, to be honest. Good news is everyone understands, right? No guardrails are being put, and any guardrail won't sustain the challenge of time if it is not really for the good reason. So it's all seem to come across very obvious. Of course, you have few characters in every sort of things, and then the tension escalates. But if one steps back and think about it, right, ultimately everything is worth building if it remains perpetually. And if you apply that thought, then in an industry like us, we have a term for it, no Mickey Mouse use cases should be built, because everything should be scaled, otherwise why do it? And all the overhead that you have, not to just build it, but operationalize it and then perpetually run it, we typically take a 5-year view, if not longer, then it's perhaps time worth spent in not moving as fast and innovating for the sake of it, something that will just fizzle out anyway for some reason. So the tension is there, but perhaps there's good understanding.
So just thinking about it, Thomas, you talked about how you've got quite far down that adoption process. What other challenges have you encountered in doing that? Other than obviously in banking, there's the compliance issue, but what other challenges have you encountered and how have you got through?
Right. So we took a very different approach in this case. So we didn't say, okay, let's build something customer facing that has to be accurate with lots of guardrails and super compliant from the get-go, but we looked at internal productivity first. And for my developers, if I can give them nothing or something that's directionally correct most of the time and provides value to them, no customer is impacted by that if it goes wrong, right? And they will be happy to feedback and say, this is nonsense, you have to tweak this, you have to make it better. And then I give them access to the code base and say, knock yourself out, right? So we took a very different approach to that. Now, there were still quite some barriers and some problems, of course. First of all is, if you want to experiment with this kind of stuff on my bank laptop, I can't, because access to nearly everything I'm using is blocked, right? Until I can prove that it's useful and I can go with compliance and CISO and to get all of this to be unblocked, which takes a lot of time, which takes time away from the ability to just see, does it even work? Is it even worth having those discussions, right? So a lot of the initial work was done on my private laptop, just try it out, right? I want to connect to Hugging Face, I connect to Hugging Face. I want to connect to this, I want to connect to that, I just do it so that we can test stuff and see, is it even worth having these discussions? Will it directionally, are the thoughts that we have, are they valid thoughts, right? Can we get to a point? Then, of course, at some point in time, you say, okay, now we have to operationalize it. We have to test it with our real code base, not with my private Git repos, which is a very different story, right? With my private Git repos, I can do whatever I want. With the corporate code, I cannot, right? So then you have to, of course, go through all the hoops and say, we need access to this, we need access to that, and then people will tell you, but we're building a corporate platform for AI, and you have to start using this, and then you have these discussions, right? But so I think that is a key element. And I think the other key element is that a lot of people don't have the vision to see how awesome this can be and how fast you can build it. So I think from discussing the idea with a team of DataStax at a RAG event to the very first prototype was a week. Right? Mm-hmm. Then in the next few weeks, we took it to a system that we could experiment. Right? We've run codes through 10 different LLMs automatically. We've run it through a bunch of different Git repos fully automatically so that we could play with it. Yeah? So I think the speed, and people were still talking, you have to generate a business case when we had something that is essentially good enough for production ready. Yeah? So the speed with which you can do these things doesn't match what the banks are used to.
So you talked quite a bit about we there.
Yeah.
So is this happening sort of top down? Is this happening as an organization? Or you talked about 1,000 developers.
Yeah.
Or are you letting them loose? How are you managing this?
So we're doing this with a very small team. Right. Just a handful of people that wants to do it, is interested and wants to get it right so that we could essentially enable experimentation. And that's key, right? It's not like you can write a project plan first and say it's going to take you 16 man days to do X and Y and Z with technology your team has never used. So don't even try, right? Enable a small team, and that's what we did. Enable a small team to say, let's just build something. Let's make it work, right? We think we should be able to do this, push this into backstage, so let's figure out how to do that, done. We think we should be able to do that, yes, it works. We think we should be able to do this, didn't work, why not? Fix, rinse, repeat, right? The speed of experimentation is not something you can normally do in a bank. Certainly not if you put the crown jewels in there, not if you put the code base in there, not if you put customer data in there and anything like that. But if you find the right attitude and enable a team to actually learn, that's massively important. And the learning piece is where it really becomes important, because this technology is not going to go away. Right? the more the teams learn how to use it, the more they're enabled to say, oh, I know how to do this with LangChain or LangFlow or this or that, and I know how this model works versus that model, the faster they can solve then more business-oriented problems in the future. Well, but you have to be creative in overcoming those barriers without doing nasty things.
Right. We're going to leave some time for some questions, so this is just a primer to think of your questions. But a final question in terms of the panel for each of you. What gets you most excited? What are the use cases? Maybe, Michael, we'll start with you, looking into the future with AI. What are the use cases that are going to most excite you?
Yeah, I think Sam Altman was talking a few days ago, and he talked about LLMs as sort of the first stage, and more advanced reasoning as sort of that next stage, which with 4.0 sort of at that stage now. And he talked about that next stage being agents. And he had this quote, and it was along the lines of, I can foresee a time in the very near future where an agent is coordinating my healthcare for me. Now, fortunately, in the UK, that's not as much of an issue as it is in the US, which is, I think, what he was referring to. But this idea of going from just information, co-piloting, et cetera, to how can you, and augmenting, into automation. Now, today at Bud, we released a sort of a new consumer agent. Is that going to be the first thing that people adopt? The chances of that are probably quite low. But inside of a bank, for example, there are so many processes, workflows in the mid-back office. And this is what a speaker earlier was talking about in terms of that are ripe for efficiency so that you can do more with that. And I think that as we see more kind of stuff coming out of just co-pilots and more into that sort of agentic banking world, I think that's where we'll see a whole new level of gains, not just the sort of productivity gains that we've seen with LLMs and sort of that reasoning in the first couple of levels.
Himanshu, same question. What excites you for the future?
Yeah, it's a wide spectrum, right? So developer productivity, et cetera, some of the easier ones, they were actually not seem easy 5 years ago, but they're the easier ones. I think there's a category of use cases where we think we are either able to improve customer satisfaction fundamentally or able to be efficient very significantly. And if you apply those lenses, then it goes into some of the customer-facing interaction that I spoke about. There's a huge knowledge base, there's a huge first-party data that we hold. Are you able to best exploit it? So one exciting use case, I think it's a category of them where you're able to affect the end outcome for the customer. And yeah, That's where the thrust is. That's where the investments are.
Yeah, makes sense. Thomas.
Right. So I'll keep going on about knowledge management because I think it's a great subject. And what we're doing today is sort of scratching the tip of the iceberg. It's easy. Everybody should be able to build this with LangFlow in a day, more or less. Right? So if I'm thinking this forward and thinking what our internal IDP champion wants us to do, right? I showed him the demo and he said, that's awesome, but I also want to do, I want to be able to ask this thing, if I have this idea, how should I architect my code, right? And if I have these principles, how should I do that? And then the ability to put reasoning, more reasoning capabilities in there and say, given that this is what we have, how should we refactor it to make it 1/10 of the current code base? Things like that. And being able as a developer to go back to writing at the speed of thought. Right? So if somebody walks to me, back in the old days in the startup, somebody could walk up to me in a meeting and say, I think we should change this application to that. And because of what we had in place there, and because it was a fairly simple set of applications, we could essentially turn this around in hours and show them and make it live an hour later. Right? But today, with the complexity of our systems, that's absolutely impossible. But I want to go back to that developer experience where the developer says, we should be able to do that. And they can, and super fast, and it actually works, and it's safe to make those changes. Because then you can actually really start to innovate instead of doing just more of the same. Right. And that's, I think, what's going to be fascinating.
We've managed to leave some time for questions.
Yes.
I see one over here. In fact, I see several over here. So if we I'll work my way around that way, if that's okay.
Thank you. So it's very interesting, and you mentioned agents. Banks, financial institutions, make a lot of money because they know things and understand things that consumers and corporate accounts don't. Now that AI agents are becoming mainstream and more consumable, we're beginning to see that the consumer is using these bots back at us. How are you going to deal with the fact that the customer is now not me, it's my AI, which understands your banking things rather better than I do? Is that how will you deal with that arms race?
Michael?
Sure. I think it's going to be interesting, and I think it's something I don't think we fully know the answer to yet either. I think the combination, there have been a number of massive changes in banking over recent years, faster payments, open banking, and now sort of this idea of agents. And I think the collection of those three things is going to have impacts to the some of the core foundations of banking. But I don't think we know what that looks like yet, is the truth. And I think the next few years will be a really interesting time as we sort of start to look at what that looks like, do that inside of regulatory sandboxes and so on and so forth to understand what that is, but also making sure we're safeguarding consumers throughout that process.
There were two questions over there, yes.
Great. Hi, my name is Aki. I'm building AI for market research. Now, my question is, how do you think about the build versus buy framework in the context of Gen AI? And is that any different to any other technology environment?
Yeah, I want to respond to that, right? It's a good question. It's a constant, call it a tussle. But I found some patterns over the years, right? So you go for build if it is the significant maturity. Sometimes you're overconfident by your maturity. And you know, it doesn't matter how many times you have failed, you first try to build if you have significant mass. There's a lot of discussion about developer productivity. Developers are very strong, opinionated people, and I've been myself. But that tends to be not the best route to take, et cetera. So, and the second dimension is the product, because they specialize, you know, fintechs, for example, they specialize in pushing the boundaries of what's possible in a generic technology. They come up with the best outcome from a model or an AI use case quicker and at scale. So therefore, I'm seeing the trend where we are making more and more buy decision. However, it's a good decision in a point in time. What happens with a buy decision is, over a period of time, somebody mentioned with the co-pilot or some the automation within the cockpit, your developers become more like, you know, developers and businesses have become more like, you know, pilot who can only run using autopilot, and they kind of start losing skills. You start getting away from your data because all the native intelligence in those products where you have shipped all the data and they are coming with. So it's a tough one. If you are under time pressure, buy looks good. But if you are building a more perpetual, more enduring systems, then you got to invest in build, not entirely drop the build.
I saw one more question on that table and then one at the back, so, yep.
Thank you. My question to Mr. Thomas. It was wonderful hearing about the developer experience and the work that we did in Santander.
Sorry, oh, can't hear you.
Yes.
Can you speak up, please?
Are you able to hear me now?
Better.
Okay, cheers, thanks. My question is to Thomas. Thanks for giving us an outline about how the AI is experienced on the developer experience side of things. Has any developer found any job security related questions, or AI is doing better at this job than themselves?
Sorry.
How do we handle this?
Job security.
Has any developer found that this is doing the job better than themselves?
In terms of documenting the code, or in terms of finding the code? So I guess go by evidence, right? If I look through a random sampling of our repositories, the documentation is non-existing. So the system does a hell of a lot better job than any of the developers we currently work with. It also does it every night if necessary. So if you make a change, to the code base, you can just regenerate the documentation and it will be up to date. Developers will not do that consistently. Your average developer certainly is not going to consistently deliver the same level of quality unless you take them through a 6 to 18 months training journey, which a lot of them say they don't have time for. Now, I've worked with teams where that had the exact same attitude, and after a year, they were all writing beautiful documentation for the code base. Right? So, but typically, what I see is what we get out of the system is very accurate and very exhaustive. And we also get things out that we didn't ask for. So I asked for an architectural summary of a repo, and it gave me hints for refactoring as well on top. I hadn't asked for that, but it thought, hey, you should do that, that, that. So I think this is a lot of the stuff that comes out is surprisingly good. I think, and that's very encouraging. But we also trained it, of course. We use Gina AI code embeddings. So they're trained on code with human language. We then use CodeStral and a bunch of others. We use Gemini, OpenAI, as I said, 10 different ones. What you do find is that if you use the wrong LLM, you just get garbage.
Yeah.
Okay. So we tried it with Tiny Llama, for example, and nope. That is not what you need.
Do we have time for just there was one question at the very back. No? Okay, well, sorry. Well, we'll have to wrap it up there then. Hopefully you found that helpful. Really appreciate you guys joining us on the panel, so thank you.
You're welcome. Thank you.